Guten Morgen, Gamescom. Hello, everyone.
Guten Morgen, Chris. It's good to have you here. Looking serious, looking good.
Yes.
So we already heard quite a bit about the new update coming to Splatoon 2, but you're here to tell us all about it.
Yes, so I have some additional research findings to share. So maybe we can start with the Manta Maria stage, and later on we'll move to the Bubble Blower.
I would love that. Let's dive into it.
All right. So our research shows that Manta Maria is a very long and also a very narrow stage.
Yeah, it looks like it.
What this means is that Inklings will often encounter each other, and it will be difficult to hold your ground. Speaking about the grounds, there are three masts on this giant boat, and those are covered by a large open area. So these will be the primary battle zones where the Inklings will fight it out. However, it's going to be difficult to defend these zones because there are a lot of different ways in which you can enter the zones.
Yeah, I see.
So, as Mr. Nogami said, it's not only about offense, but it's also about defense. Two zones are going to be very, very crucial. The spot over here and the spot over here allow skilled Inklings to swim into enemy territory and cover the ground from there. So you always have to be on your guard, because before you know it, the end of a map might look like this, and we can see that both teams have skillfully flanked each other, but have forgotten to defend their own zone. So it's not only about offense, it's also about defense, which will make Manta Maria a very exciting and thrilling match to play. And what better way to do that than to have two teams of skilled Nintendo employees battle it out on stage. They take their Inklings to Manta Maria. I would say, take it away.
Yeah, we're also joined by our colleagues. For once, it's Bowie, who will be commentating the matches. Welcome. And also Filippo, buongiorno Filippo, who will be running the spectator camera. So we're looking forward to that. And we're diving into the match right now as both teams getting ready. I think we can start. If you guys are ready, looks like it. Let's go.
Okay, excited to see our first match here on the Manta Maria. Looks glorious, it really does.
So excited.
Oh yes, okay, so the yellow team is our team on the far side over here, and the blue team on this side for everyone here who's watching, and it's underway. So obviously we're going to be using the spectator camera, we're going to see the overall map here, and you can see that obviously, as Chris said, it was very narrow and also very, very, very long. As our players, the blue team, making their way along the right-hand side, whereas the yellow team going straight for that center. Less flanking going on right now. The yellow team have met there, but so far, no actual tussles yet from the two. There's already the
bubble blower.
Bubble blower. Sorry, the beast today.
Being executed.
Being used, yeah. So what you can do with it, as you can see, is these big old bubbles coming out. We're going to go into that a little bit later. So we're going to be watching player five just making their way back in, keeping a lot of space open so they can get some more points in as they go.
I think one thing which you can already see is that Manta Maria has a lot of elevation. Yeah. What this means is that not only is it difficult to cover the ground because there are so many entry points into the three zones surrounding the masts, but it's also, once you have that zone, you can of course find a vantage point, but it also makes you vulnerable when you can get shot through the netting.
Really good work there from player five as well, who was just pressurizing their opponent very, very nicely on that edge. Tried to go for the jump, but unfortunately missed it. So player five does fall down. So let's go back up. And we say player two here in the center, using the high point on that mast, just to control the center a little bit. But we're going to check in with player one now, who's making their way around that flank, going to try and maybe support their teammates and control that central point. Their special, the blower, the bubble blower, is ready and going to be using that very, very shortly. As we can see, this yellow team does have control of the center, as blue team does also make their way across. Just on the right-hand side there, player one does have the ability to go in potentially and take them out.
Yeah, so our research findings show that usually when one team is controlling the middle, it means that the other team, like what is happening here, is actually controlling the two other masts. So again, offense as a team is good, but don't forget to defend.
It's a player five here who had a little bit of a moment. They're going to try and support their teammate, but looking around for that turf war. As important as it is to get those splats on your opponent, you really want to make sure you're covering as much ground. That's kind of what turf war is all about, as we all know. Player 7 here just using that roller to kind of try and cover as much as possible. Player 5 gets spotted by Player 3. Wonderful shots there. Nice tracking of the position, locking down and getting those shots. Taking control of that central point as well. Player 4 now and Player 6 tussling just in this slight space there, but Player 6 wins that and makes their way towards the opponent's side of the base. Very good work from Player 6.
Yeah, so one crucial aspect that we have seen in our research is that if you get splatted in the last minute, it's usually a very dangerous spot. And that's what you can see here. Player 6 is winning the tussle, and that means that he can splat a lot of the area surrounding the mast closest to the enemy base, doing a lot of good work for its team. Is it going to be enough? We will see it now.
It's coming down to the final seconds, and that is the game. So let's see, have a look at this map and see how it looks. It's looking very strong for yellow, but we'll have to see what Judd and Lil Judd say.
Wow. Point.
What a close one. Unbelievable.
I have to say, this is one of the tightest matches that we have seen so far in our research. But of course, our research has only just started because we have just recently discovered this area.
But what we were able to see is actually exactly what you said. Like, the center pillar is especially important. People try to avoid it once an enemy is up there, for example, and they try to flank instead. And we were also able to get a glimpse of the bubble blower.
Yes. So maybe this is a good moment to go a bit more in-depth into the bubble blower. Because basically, what it does is it allows you to throw three bubbles. It's a special weapon, so that means that you first have to activate it, and then you can wave it to throw three bubbles that will be floating nicely through the stage. However, you can use an extra trick, because when you shoot at the bubbles, they will explode, which means that you can splat some Inklings that are not paying attention. However, as an enemy Inkling, you also have a way to defend yourself. Because by shooting at an enemy bubble, you can shrink it all the way down until it's small and it just disappears. However, there's another way, a defensive trick for the bubble blower, and that's that when you use the bubble blower yourself, for instance in a narrow corner like this, you can see that you can use it as a shield to block enemy ink and get away yourself.
That sounds like me. That's something I would do, definitely.
I think, again, this is a good moment to jump into the next battle so that we can see the bubble blower in action.
Yeah, let's do it.
We will really focus on the bubble blower because there are a lot of spectacular explosions and splats to be found.
We saw quite a few happening already, but this time we're going to focus on the bubble blower and we will see how the players are going to use it. And Bowie, you have seen it already.
Yeah, I have,
yeah. It's quite interesting, isn't it?
It was a very, very close game as well, that first one. So now we're going to, as we say, we're going to have a little bit of a better look at this at the bubble blower. Excuse my bees today, they're not very good. So we're going to hopefully see a bunch of the different strategies that our players will be employing to really showcase all of its versatility, both offensively and defensively. Especially when, Chris, you mentioned just how good it is when it comes to those tighter corridors and on those lower sections of the Manta Maria is going to be very, very helpful, you know, when trying to either fall back or not. But we're getting straight into game now, so let's go for it here. This stage is wonderful. It obviously should be noted as well, if you've just joined us, that the central mast on the Manta Maria is climbable, whereas the two on the sides, I believe, are not. So again, just watching all of our players go, and then we'll be starting off, obviously, by clearing as much as covering as much ground as possible to really get that special up so we can see these bubbles in action. So player 5 and 3, let's go check out 3 as these two get close to their first tussle in the game. Player 3, obviously their opponents are above, need to try and find a way to get rid of that pressure. We see the bubbles being employed by the blue team and they're underway now from player 3. Again, getting these shots out and covering all that ground, very, very nice. Player 3, though, being pressurized and taken out by player 6, who did a very, very good job.
Which is actually also an interesting finding, that when you use the bubble blower, because you are focused on waving the three bubbles, it also makes you briefly vulnerable to enemy counterattacks if you get flanked. So always be mindful of your surroundings.
So yeah, do not just defensive in terms of blockading or by covering ground, but also a distraction technique, which I think is very, very nice about this. Changing up the way it looks. So we can see now, let's have a look at player 6 and 3 who are tussling on the yellow side base. Player 6 trying to get away as player 3 is pressurizing on the back now. How will our players deal with this? Circling around each other. Ooh, player three just clutching that out very nicely. That Forge Spattershot Pro doing some good damage there. And player six looking to get that squid, that super jump in to the fray. Players four and five now again tussling. Player six just going to try and cover as much as he can. You can see there's this lovely kind of dialogue between both teams. Player three just getting rid of that bubble, or trying to. There we go. And it's gone. Okay. Completely nullified.
This is actually mentioned before. You can neutralize these bubbles by shooting at them and making sure that they slowly disappear and don't splat into your face.
Player three, very nice. Using the master to get that higher ground and now pressurizing the opponent. Very good there from player three. Getting the splat on player eight as their opponent is going to push against them. Gets the double splat there from player three, doing a really good job. And the bubble blower is active. One, two, and three. And using those just to cover as much ground as possible. Really good work there from our Inkling here.
Yes, that was actually a very clever trick to activate the bubble blower before falling down, because that way there was a shield of bubbles on a different levels of elevation, so it was a much bigger shield.
Okay, so player four now in the opponent's base, covering as much, using that flanking you were talking about Chris, to really get into the enemy base and kind of take them by surprise, blindside them with covering their side of the map.
It looks like the Inklings have been quite aggressively attacking each other and not covered every bit of the ground yet.
5 seconds left. Four, three, two, and one. And the time is up. This game's looking very close as well. Well, Chris, how well have our Inklings learned about this new discovery?
Well, I think we saw, again, a few interesting research findings. Wow, Woo! It was again very close.
The bad guys have won. Players.
But I particularly liked the waving of the bubble on the higher level, then jumping down and activating the second and the third bubble, because it really gives you a lot of protection.
I would assume as well that the bubble being when you kind of aggress upon it and use your ink, obviously, to make it grow bigger to eventually explode, the higher up it is, the more ground it covers as well, because it showers down in a much wider range. So obviously that height works on two levels, not only for regular weapons, but also for the blower as well.
I have to say, this is something that additional research is needed for.
Fair
so
enough.
I would appreciate it if players will continue the research also in Splatoon 2 when the bubble blower becomes available. Mm. It will first become available as part of a set with the Forge Splattershot Pro from September 2nd. But before we go to that, let's jump into one more final battle. Yeah. And I would like to once again raise attention to the central mast in Manta Maria, because this is the one that is climbable.
And we saw some tough matches happening there already. So.
Exactly. We already saw some people using the nets here to really ink all the way around them. And this is one of those strategies where it really pays off to find a higher ground. But of course, people can also attack you from all the different sides, so it's also dangerous. Let's see how our Inklings deal with that tip in the final round.
Yeah, let's jump into game three, and it was, for me, quite interesting to see how they used the bubble blower in a way that once one player saw the enemy's bubbles, and he didn't really know how to handle it. Like, do I just go back, or do I try to hit it to make it smaller? It's interesting to see how many ways are possible to use it.
I think what's also important is that players have to make a decision. They're forced to make a decision, which can, if they're not ready for that particular usage, can, you know, put them on the back foot a little bit.
And we also saw some players just like bubbling around and forgetting about their surroundings, something you mentioned before.
Okay, so yeah, that's the thing. It's such an enjoyable weapon that you don't want to kind of like get caught up in the moment of this new exciting skill. So again, we're going to see player five really making their way straight towards the center there, as player three and four are just going to again push around the side, or push around the sides of the center as player two does a bit more housekeeping at the back. So players three and five now in the center, the higher ground for player five, the lower ground for player three. So they're going to try and cover as much as they can here. You can see that line disappearing. Player three looking just to cover as much ground as possible. He has his bubble blower available now. One, two, and three. He's got them going. and uses them to cover that ground very, very nicely. Oh, wonderful double, yeah. Double splat from player three immediately. Actually, wonderful play.
Actually, what I really liked even more was the way that the bubbles were blown, because they were shot sequentially, so they exploded into each other and really covered a lot of the ground. Gave him a good protection and also a good splatting.
Oh, this is not looking good for player four right now.
What a tough spot.
Get out of there! Get out of there! That was inevitable, unfortunately, for player four. Completely trapped in the opponent. Look at the yellow team now. Complete domination of that central point. Players five, six, seven, and eight are going to have to do it. So we've got player five coming around the side now, and player six on player one as well. So we've got, let's have a look at player six as their bubble blower is activated. So many blue bubbles in the center. Okay, there we go. Player one taking that splat for him and then covering that ground as well. I'm liking that these individual bubbles are very much like the Rainmaker shields.
Yeah.
So they each work in that kind of property. They can be shot against if you want to get it, and then it explodes in your favor. But there's three of them.
But one thing that we've already seen quite often, both in our research and today, is when activating the bubble, you often get splatted yourself.
Yes.
So.
But it's worth it. Totally worth it.
Because I mean, you do have to use up all of the bubbles first before you can get back into splatting. So you have
exactly.
to decide, do you want to, if you have a teammate with you, are you going to go in and throw that out and let your teammates deal with the bubbles one by one, or do you just want to get them all out and then you can deal with it yourself? You're defenseless in a way when you are actually using the bubbles, because you can't do anything, really.
Timing is very important.
This is a very, very close game, though, as the blue team are making a way to really push back into the yellow team's half, saying that player four getting inside the opponent's base, and again, using those bubbles to really cover some nice ground, and just taking away every tiny bit of percentage for the opponent. Very, very good. But the blue team have caught on, but a very nice counter splat from player four. Holding his ground really nicely right now as we're into the last 10 seconds, but player seven takes it back. Okay, how's it going to go as we finish it up? Can the blue team get the counter they need? Two, one, and I think if my trained eye is ready, it looks like it's the good guys, the yellow team, taking this one with a clean 16.3% advantage. They finally get their victory.
Indeed it is. So are you happy with your research?
This was a beautiful display of the new Manta Maria stage and the Bubble Blower special weapon, I think. I would like to see additional research, but of course, players can help us with this, because Manta Maria, the stage, will become available from this Saturday, 26th of August. And the Bubble Blower, as a special weapon, will first become available as a set with the Forged Splattershot Pro weapon from September 2nd. So I am looking forward to seeing more research being done by all our Inklings across the globe.
But not just across the globe, because I know that there's something special for everyone around here at Gamescom, right?
You are entirely right, because we, as a special gift from the European Research, X-Squid Research Lab, have provided you with Splatoon 2 here on the show floor, which includes the Manta Maria stage and also includes the Bubble Blower special weapon, so you can already test it out here at Gamescom.
Awesome. So use this time wisely. Try to get ahead of your friends. That's what I would do at least. Right, Bowie? He laughs. We know where we can find him over
there. Every little advantage helps. Every little bit.
The next days. Yeah, right. So thank you very, very much, Chris. Thank you very much to our guys here on stage, our high-skilled Nintendo employees who showcase what a good Splatoon match looks like. It's always interesting to see, because even in the last seconds, everything can change. I love that about Splatoon. Yeah. So for this moment, I would say thank you to all of you tuning in. Thank you guys, obviously, for joining us here at the show floor. And I would love for you guys to tune in tomorrow at 11 a.m. We're going to start with ARMS, another fantastic game with fantastic new content. That much we can say. So please tune in tomorrow, and if you're around at Gamescom, make sure to come by over the course of the next days. We would love that. So thank you very much to Bowie. Thank you very much, Filippo. Thank you very much to you guys here on stage. Thank you to our lovely audience here at Gamescom, and thanks for tuning in. See you tomorrow. Bye.